Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of The Wild One, The Life and Times of Johnny O'Keefe, written by Damian Johnstone and read by Peter Hosking. Chapter 1. Cry. The 1930s was not a happy period for many Australians. Although not hit as hard as other Western economies, Australia nevertheless suffered severely from the rippling effects of the Wall Street crash in October 1929, which wiped out billions of dollars of investments in a matter of days and heralded the Great Depression. Soon share prices had plummeted, and as the value of money dwindled, businesses closed, farms were abandoned, and people who could not pay their rent were forced out of their homes. Thousands were out of work by 1930, and those lucky enough to have a job were battling for a living as wages were cut and permanent jobs became part-time, even casual. In the early 1930s, to ease the pain and suffering, Australians took to going to the pictures, ballroom dancing, listening to the wireless, and following the exploits of sporting heroes such as Don Bradman, Walter Lindrum, Hubert Opperman, and the racehorse Farlap. It was into this environment that John Michael O'Keefe was born on the 19th of January 1935, the second son to Ray and Thelma O'Keefe. Brother Barry had been born in 1933, the year after the O'Keefes married. At the time of John's birth, the O'Keefes lived in Sabre Street, Bondi Junction. Footnote: the small Sydney street of half a dozen terraced houses is now cut off from Bondi Junction by Sid Enfield Drive and officially located in Woollahra. End of footnote. Ray O'Keefe had not been hit as hard as many by the Depression, and shortly after John's birth, Ray's success in the furniture trade led to the family moving to a bigger home in Dover Heights, in Sydney's eastern suburbs. The O'Keefe family was complete with the birth of Anne in 1937. Ray was very sporting-minded and also a fine pianist, playing at the Bondi Surf Club and leading his own dance band, the Club Royals. His band practiced in the family home on occasions. Both parents were known to have good singing voices, and Thelma was also a fine pianist. She had achieved success in the hardware trade before settling into life as a housewife and mother. The O'Keefes were a respectable, middle-class, community-minded, Catholic church-going family, and were well-liked by their neighbours. Ray was popular with adults and young people alike. Thelma was, according to neighbour Marie Kelly, very Australian, but always laying down the law. She says the O'Keefe children all had plenty of confidence, but the mother did all the talking. When John was just a small boy, he became known around the neighbourhood as Little Devil. Marie describes the young O'Keefe as excitable and a headache. He was always darting here, there and everywhere. John had developed a lazy eye, which meant that he wore glasses for a time from the age of 15 months. Thelma described him as being strong-willed right from childhood. She says he liked to go to sleep early, no matter where he was. "I always remember him one night nodding off at the dinner table. Ray gently lifted him on his shoulders to take him to bed. John opened one eye and said, 'I think the white ants have got at you, Dad.' Ray was covered in cigarette ash." John idolised his brother, so when Barry was ready to start school at Waverley College, run by the Christian Brothers, there was no question in John's mind that he would start as well, even though he was under school age. After much persistence, John was finally accepted as a student. School didn't quieten John, however, and he was soon living up to his nickname in class, so much so that his somewhat frustrated teacher, Brother Monagle, contacted his mother. Thelma suggested that if John continued to be a nuisance, he should be handed his hat and school bag, told he wasn't wanted, and sent home. This did the trick. John feared rejection and immediately burst into tears. Brother Monagle, obviously a softy at heart, was soon comforting the sobbing boy and withdrew his threat. John was very taken with the gesture and told his mother later that day that Brother loved him. It's said that Brother Monagle referred to John that day as Johnny, supposedly the first time this form of his name had been used. Although his family and friends always referred to him as John, he became known professionally as Johnny, and for this reason, that name will be used from here on. Johnny made his first public performance on stage in 1939 at the Waverley College School Concert and Speech Night. The junior school performed a scene from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs in a hall at the Sydney Conservatorium of Music. Johnny played Dopey. He was 4 years old, going on 5 at the time. "Over the years, I often reminded him of his playing Dopey," says one of Johnny's first teachers, Brother Frank Mazzarini. "He'd defend it, saying that he was really acting and that it was a hard part to play. I suggested he was just being himself." Australia's recovery from the Depression was slow, and full employment did not return until the outbreak of the Second World War in 1939. During the war, there was rationing of petrol, household drapery, tea, beer, sugar, butter, cocoa, chocolate, meat and clothes, so family life was still pretty tough. Pressure was also strong on young Australians to enlist in the services. There were fears of invasion from Japan and demands to work hard to sustain the nation and economy in a time of great need. In the meantime, Johnny continued his primary school education. His grades fluctuated due to his misbehaviour and his tendency to be easily distracted. However, in 1941, he was dux of the class in second grade, while his close friend Peter Fingleton finished 5th. The following year, Johnny won a prize for religious knowledge, and he finished 7th in class. In 1944, he was 3rd in 5th class, so, despite being somewhat erratic, he was beginning to achieve success early in his life. Between 1940 and 1947, Brother Mazzarini was stationed at St. Patrick's in Strathfield, in Sydney's inner west, and his association with Johnny was spasmodic. Brother returned to Waverley in 1947 and became the major in charge of the school cadets. Johnny was one of 370 cadets at the college and played the bugle in the band. He made sound progress, being promoted to Lance Corporal and then Sergeant. Brother Mazzarini ultimately managed to acquire a trumpet, which he gave to Johnny, and he was now able to provide some harmony to the band. In 1950, those harmony skills were demonstrated, but not as Brother Mazzarini had envisaged. When the cadets went to Bathurst to attend a national fitness camp, Brother invited a retired brigadier and the Bishop of Bathurst to attend a ceremonial parade. As these dignitaries inspected the cadets, the band was playing the golden harp. Johnny, who had been playing harmony, suddenly started to jazz it up. I looked threateningly at him, but he wouldn't look my way. When it was all over, I summoned him up to explain his conduct. He naturally denied jazzing it up, and of course I couldn't prove it. Future legendary Sydney radio breakfast personality Gary O'Callaghan was a classmate of Johnny's and remembers that he was always in strife at school. That's how I got to know his name, because the teacher said it so often, like it was, "O'Keefe, be quiet. O'Keefe, face the front." Gary referred to his schoolmate as Jokels, and the name stuck for the rest of Johnny's life. I don't know why, but it was just one of those things that flowed, I guess. To most at Waverley College, however, Johnny was known as Squeak. John Rolls remembers the name resulted from the continual reference made by choir master Fatty O'Brien. Well, Johnny was such a tiny little guy, and Fatty O'Brien would say, "Where's that squeak coming from?" Brother Mazzarini describes Johnny as a very kindly boy, but says he could be intolerant of people that were odd, or slow on the uptake, or even not much good at doing things. Johnny was perceptive, being able to see through the emptiness of people. He was a streetwise sort of kid. And he was always full of fun and mischief, although seldom of a destructive nature. Most times the mischief concerned inattention. He could be distracted easily and be a damn nuisance at times and a plague on what you were trying to do, but he knew where the difference lay between fun and being rude. Johnny could go to that line, but he'd never step across it. Brother also remembers Johnny's great sense of humour. Sometimes, however, that humour got Johnny into strife, particularly when he got together with Peter Fingleton. For a time, the two mates were jumping on Bondi trams and selling the previous day's newspaper to unsuspecting travellers. The scheme was quite profitable until word got back to Brother. I told them that I considered it was very unreasonable and very dishonest. They thought it was good fun. Thelma O'Keefe recalled another prank from the war years. John came to me one afternoon and said, "Mum, you'll kill me, but I have to tell you. Fingo and I have changed all the numbers of the buses at Waverley Depot. Everyone will catch the wrong bus." Of course, it was a very wrong thing to do, and I should have chastised him, but the way he told it, tears of laughter were just pouring over my face. Johnny wasn't sports-minded at school, but Waverley had a policy of compulsory participation, so he found himself playing rugby. He enjoyed swimming, however. Doug Ifland lived in the next block up from the O'Keefes and spent a lot of time with Johnny and Barry. Well, John was always pretty active with the Bondi Amateur Swimming Club because Ray O'Keefe was in the club. On Sunday mornings, they all swam competitively at the Bondi Baths. John was okay at swimming and kept up with everybody, so his size never worried him. Doug was fond of Johnny's parents. Well, Mrs. O'Keefe was outgoing and John took after her. He was an extrovert and very outgoing. Ray was one of the greatest human beings I've ever met. He took an interest in young people, and to me he was just another dad. Although Johnny was always keen on music, he didn't sing around the house much, the way some kids do. He preferred to listen, although he would join the rest of the family in a sing-along while his father played the piano in the family's large dining room. When he was 10, Johnny very reluctantly stood in as the hymn soloist in the school choir, singing "Holy God, We Praise Thy Name." But Thelma's lasting impression of Johnny's childhood is of him lying on the carpet with his head under the wireless. He was mad on the radio and couldn't seem to get enough of it. Radio had been a great comfort to Australians during the war, both for news and entertainment. Certain programs would see families sit down and literally watch the radio. Some of the better-known programs through the 1940s included the Argonauts Club, Dad and Dave, the Quiz Kids, Australia's Amateur Hour, Blue Hills, and Macaque Mansion. Music was also big on radio, and by 1948, stations affiliated with the Australian Federation of Commercial Broadcasting Stations were devoting no less than 55% of airtime to various musical shows. The ABC wasn't far behind with 53%. Every kind of popular music was featured, from crooning, band recitals, hymns, community singing, hillbilly music, jazz and jive, through to big band music. Life in Australia in the early 1950s was more stable than it had been for many years. Robert Menzies' Liberal government had assumed power in 1949, and within a few years the worst effects of the Second World War had receded. The economy was growing steadily. Industrial development, foreign investment, particularly from America, and mineral discoveries were booming. Families were gradually achieving higher standards of living. The US influence became increasingly apparent as Australians drifted away from the old British values of thrift and prudence to the American way of the pursuit of happiness through consumption. Household appliances such as refrigerators and washing machines became a part of every Australian home. Many families purchased such items on hire purchase, that is, on the buy now, pay later premise. The early 1950s also saw a large population increase from both the post-war baby boom and the Commonwealth government's policy of population growth through immigration. Between 1945 and 1952, some 720,000 immigrants arrived in Australia, including approximately 360,000 British and 170,000 displaced persons, mostly from Eastern Europe. Employment was high, particularly in the building and light and medium industries. Home ownership increased. Farmers' incomes grew significantly following high demand for wool and foodstuffs. At first, many were sceptical about the boom lasting. It was all too easy to look back to the war and the Depression. But the decade began to roll along smoothly, and the scepticism gradually disappeared. Johnny did well in 1951, his last year at Waverley, attaining an A in French and B's in English, general mathematics, physics and economics. In 1952, he enrolled in a part-time economics degree course at Sydney University, but after a year he realised he'd made a mistake. He wasn't prepared to work at something that didn't much interest him, so he tossed the course in and enrolled in a short retail traders course. He subsequently went to work as a furniture salesman in his father's store in Pitt Street, Sydney. His sister Anne also joined the family business while Barry pursued legal studies. While John performed periodically at school dances and at Catholic youth organisation socials from fourth year onwards, his interest in singing really...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.